Okay, so we're going to switch gears a bit now. We're going to talk about some of the practicalities. Okay, and we're going to talk about how do we go about essentially getting ready to run one of these modeling algorithms on a data set. The terrible thing is, even with something as simple as occurrence data, we have to think about the concepts. So this is a very brief talk about what are the concepts we need to have in mind when we start talking about occurrence data. And they are as dots on maps, and how those dots document the presence of a species across the landscape. So, we've all, occurrence data are essentially those recorded instances where a species was at a particular place. We can define a primary biodiversity datum as a data record that places a particular species at a particular place at a particular point in time, obviously with documentation. Okay? But really what we need is species place time. Right? So an example might be something like a record of an African lion at those coordinates on that day, and the documentation is the photograph. The subcomment is that biodiversity data are extremely numerous and have until recently been extremely fragmented. And so the very best thing we can do is make our data available openly, broadly, efficiently. That was the subject of the course last week. You'll be able to see that online within a couple of weeks. So here's our BAM diagram again. And I want you to think about just a couple of points here. Remember we said that the occurrences of the species are here because this is the area that is suitable in abiotic terms, this is the area that's suitable in biotic terms, and this is the area that is accessible. And so the species should only occur there. Is that completely true? No. Because all of this area is accessible to the species. And so in theory, dispersers can go out across M more broadly than the limits imposed by A and B. And so we can find individuals of the species at these sites, but those are not viable populations. In this case, because something biotic is missing, in this case, because something abiotic is wrong, and in this case, because both are wrong. Okay? So, that's a way of getting you to think about sources and sinks. These populations are long-term viable. These populations may exist for the lifetime of an individual, or maybe just for a minute, but it may be long enough to sample. And so in that sense, we have to be a little careful of how we're sampling species, because those occurrences may represent the environments across M, rather than the environments across M that are represented in A. Okay? So it's just a note of caution, and it'll depend on the species in question. Going back to a point that Richard made, and foreshadowing a point that I'll make again, where is the species absent? It can be absent there, because somebody came and fumigated them, or because an endangered species was poached, or a forest was destroyed, even though the climate is correct. It may be absent because of metapopulation dynamics. Okay? But absence does happen even where everything's right. And then we have absence because of problems with B, because of problems with A, because of being inaccessible. But we have all sorts of reasons why a species can be absent. Notice in particular the invadable area. The species can be absent under conditions that are perfectly suitable but are outside of M. Okay? And also, by the way, your species is absent from the surface of Mars and Venus and Jupiter, which are definitely, definitely, definitely outside of the dispersal radius and probably also unsuitable environments. Okay? So think about what a presence record means versus what an absence record means. In particular, think about all of these absences, which is where the abiotic conditions are fine. Okay? That's a really critical point. I'll show it to you in a different way. This is a probability tree. You can imagine we start over here. And we're going to go through the BAM diagram right here. First, is it accessible? Is it within M? Second, is it abiotically suitable? And third, is it biotically suitable? And so we're talking about one place. First question, is it accessible? Yes or no? Second question, imagine that it is accessible. Is it suitable abiotically? Yes or no? And is it biologically suitable? Yes or no? And what I want you to notice is that only this branch of this tree can yield a presence. And all the other branches of this tree yield absences. And what's more, all of these white circles are ones where the environment, as we measure when we model niches, the environment is perfectly suitable. So all of these environmentally suitable sites nonetheless yield absences. And even if you make it through the band diagram, you have the question of whether it was sampled or whether there were some errors. So we have a lot of ways to produce absences. Essentially, all of these, we're not showing all the branches, all of these branches down here, and only this one can produce presence. That is really critical because it says that it's hard to make a presence and easy to make an absence. So presences are nearly always true, except if it's a sink population, or there could also be errors of identification or of georeferencing. Okay? Those are things that can make a presence observation false. But absence information, or lack of presence information, can come from a myriad of reasons. Maybe just nobody's ever been there. Right? Lots and lots of reasons. So what you're going to see in the course of this week is that in a lot of cases, we're going to do things that weight presence data more heavily than absence data. Just to give you an example, we're going to worry more about omission error, leaving the presence out, then we're going to worry about commission error, which is including as a predictive positive something is really negative. So we're gonna take this to heart very thoroughly. And so presence data in general should be weighted much more heavily in niche modeling applications than absence data. Then there's a whole other set of problems, and Enrique is going to talk with you about these problems. But I won't even go through the list. Simply the point is that there are lots of things that can make even presence data messy, noisy, and difficult to use. And so the real question at the end of the day, before you press that button and calibrate a niche model, the real question is whether there's enough signal that you can pick out and appreciate given all the noise. There's a favorite data set of mine that shows you a little bit of signal and a hell of a lot of noise. What do we see here? Well, we see that one country has been really, really good about reporting data. And like a couple little regions have been good at reporting data. Then we see another country. What are those regularly spaced arrays of points? Anybody know? Low precision georeferences. Something was being georeferenced to the nearest degree or the nearest half degree. Okay? Do you want to include that in a niche model, those evenly spaced points? Maybe not. And then you see big areas that are not sampled. Does that mean the species is not there? Or does it mean that somebody has observed the species and hasn't reported the data? Or hasn't made the data easily available? So this is the type of situation you're going to get into in most of the cases, unless you go out and put in the hard labor to generate your own occurrence data. And even so, you may be able to work in one country and not the next, or there may not be a road into one mountain range, okay? So this sort of messy data is universal. You'll see it every single time you look at a data set. So just to give a broad overview, occurrences are constrained by environmental and geographic, and potentially by biotic factors, right? Presences are generated by a lot of essentially good luck events. And if any of those events fails, it looks like an absence. And you have to put a lot of attention to data quality.